Good morning, everyone. I am K. Sharad Deepika, degree lecturer in botany from Telangana Tribal Welfare Residential Degree College for Women, Medak, affiliated to Usmania University. Today, I am going to take lecture on photosynthesis. Photosynthesis is the process where plants perform their own food in the presence of light. That light is sunlight. We call it as radiant energy. So this radiant energy is falling directly on the leaves, which has chlorophyll pigment. Then carbon dioxide is intaked into the leaves through minute pores called stomata, and water is absorbed from the soil through roots. So carbon dioxide and water combine in the presence of radiant energy in the chlorophyll to synthesize food called as sugars, called as carbohydrates. That food is nothing but glucose molecules that is synthesized inside the plant. And the byproduct of this procedure is oxygen. So when we enter deeply into the definition of photosynthesis, photosynthesis is anabolic, reductive, you can see here, photosynthesis is anabolic, reductive, endergonic process. Anabolic in the sense formation of complex molecules from simple substances inside living organisms is called as anabolism. So carbon dioxide and water are the simple molecules that are combining to give rise to sugars. Then next is the reductive process. Reduction in the sense addition of hydrogen. So if you see here, for the carbon dioxide, in carbon dioxide, carbon and oxygen atoms are there. But in the sugars that are formed in the products, if you see, carbon dioxide, the carbon molecule atom is there, hydrogen atom is there, and oxygen atom is there. So for carbon dioxide, hydrogens have got added. So addition of hydrogen is called as reduction. So photosynthesis is a reductive process. Endergonic process. Photosynthesis is taking energy externally, is called as endergonic process. So from where is this energy coming? This energy is coming from light reaction, that is from the sunlight. We will be seeing in the further slides how the energy is being generated in the plants and how that energy is utilized by the plants for the synthesis of sugars. So finally, if we define photosynthesis is an anabolic, a reductive, and an endergonic process which uses light energy to photochemically reduce carbon dioxide into carbohydrates, where oxygen is the byproduct. So this is the definition of photosynthesis. Coming to the next slide. Site of photosynthesis. Where is the site of photosynthesis? Leaves are the main site of photosynthesis. So, leaves are the main sites of photosynthesis. So, the leaves that are there are green in color because of the presence of chlorophyll pigments in them. These chlorophyll pigments are seen in special structures, special cell organelles called as chloroplasts. In this chloroplast, where are these chloroplasts present? These chloroplasts are present in the mesophyll cells of the leaf. If you take a section cut of a leaf, we can see the upper epidermis. We can see the upper epidermis, upper epidermis, lower epidermis, and mesophyll. Mesophyll is divided into palisade mesophyll and spongy mesophyll. So you can see all these green structures, whatever the green dots are there. This is all the presence of chlorophyll pigment, hence the leaves are occurring green in color. So these leaves are responsible for the photosynthesis process. So then leaves a green in color because of the presence of chlorophyll pigment, and these leaves are the main site. Then the plants are obtaining water from the soil through roots. From the xylem vessels, these water molecules are transporting to the leaves by a process called ascent of sap. Then next is the carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is the gas that is present in the atmosphere, and it is absorbed into the plant through minute spores present on the leaves called as stomata. So all these come into the chloroplast, and in the presence of sunlight, they form sugars. So ultimately, the cell organelles which are responsible for the food production are nothing but the chloroplasts are the main food producers. They are the food production centers in the green plants. So this is the structure, internal structure of the leaf, how the mesophyll is divided, and how the stomata, you can see the stomata here, the minute pore that is present on the leaf, which is absorbing the gas, that is the carbon dioxide. Now, the cell organelle, we have to learn about the cell organelle, the chloroplast. Chloroplast is the site of photosynthesis, I have said, the cell organelle in the plant. It is the largest organelle in the leaves in the plants. So these chloroplast is having specialized pigments. Pigments in the sense the light harvesting, the light fixing molecules in the plant, they are called as pigments. And photosynthetic pigments are those which are responsible for the process of photosynthesis. So these photosynthetic pigments like chlorophyll, carotenoids, xanthophylls, phycobilins, all these are present in this chloroplast pigment, this chloroplast organelle. This chloroplast is surrounded by a double membrane. It is an exogenous organelle that is fixing carbon dioxide. Now, in the chloroplast is having the matrix in the center, this fluid called as a stroma. In the stroma, there are thylakoids, coin-like thylakoids embedded one above the other. Just see, this is the diagram. The chloroplast is surrounded by membrane, two membranes, outer membrane and the inner membrane. And in that, the fluid, the filled with stroma. In the stroma, there are coin-like thylakoids present in the chloroplast. See, you can see pile of coins, and each one of them is called as thylakoid. Thylakoid. Stack of thylakoids is called as granum. Now, these each granum are attached to one another by lamellae called as stroma lamellae. These stroma lamellae are connecting the grana's one to the another. So this is the site of photosynthesis where the pigments are present. Now thylakoid, the region of the thylakoid which is not exposed to stroma is called as oppressed region, and the region of the thylakoid which is exposed to stroma is called as non-oppressed region. So, this oppressed region and non-oppressed region, these are response. So, this oppressed region and the non-oppressed region, we will be discussing about them when we study photosystem 1 and 2. Where photosystem 1 occurs, where photosystem 2 occurs. So, this chloroplast is the organelle. We have studied its complete structure, how it is by the diagram, and now we are going to see what are the photosynthetic pigments present inside the chloroplast organelle. After the pigments, we will be seeing the photosystems clearly. So these photosynthetic pigments are those which are absorbing light molecules That is why they are called as pigments. There are three types of pigments, as I told you, chlorophylls, carotenes, and phycobilins. These pigments are organizing themselves into a molecule called as light harvesting complex. Means they are capturing the radiant energy in the form of small packets called as photons or quanta. Those are captured directly by the light harvesting complexes and they are given to chlorophyll A molecule. Chlorophyll A molecule is that molecule which is converting this radiant energy into chemical energy. So different types of chlorophylls we'll be seeing now. These, what I mean to say is, these photosynthetic pigments are the main pigments for trapping the radiant energy. They are responsible for trapping the radiant energy. So these plants are responsible, the photosynthetic pigments are responsible to trap the radiant energy. Now in that, first we are going to see chlorophylls. Chlorophylls are the major pigments that are present in the plants. That is why the leaves appear green in color. They are green color pigments. Their structure is divided into two parts. They are having a porphyrin head and a phytol tail. A porphyrin head and a phytol tail, where the head is having four pyrrole rings with a magnesium as the center atom. I will be showing you this. Four pyrrole rings are present in the chlorophyll head. In the porphyrin head, four pyrrole rings are present, and then magnesium is the central atom present in that particular head, central atom. And then the phytol tail is a 20 carbon tail which is attached to the fourth pyrrole ring. In the four pyrrole rings of the porphyrin head, the fourth pyrrole ring is attached. This phytol tail is attached to the fourth pyrrole ring. So this is the structure of chlorophyll molecule with a head and a tail. Now, there are different types of chlorophylls we have to see. Chlorophyll A, B, C, D, E. Now, the first one we have to understand is that chlorophyll A is a universal pigment. It is present in all the organisms, living organisms that are performing photosynthesis. That means green plants, algae, okay, so whatever, bacteria, whatever living organisms, they are performing photosynthesis will be having this chlorophyll A. It is called as the universal pigment. Along with the chlorophyll A, there are other chlorophyll pigments like B, C, D, E. Now, all the green plants are having chlorophyll A along with that chlorophyll B. Now, Phaeophyce and Phaeophyce and Basilariophyce will be having chlorophyll A and chlorophyll C. Chlorophyll A and C. Rhodophyce, that is the red algae, is having chlorophyll A and chlorophyll D. And Xanthophyce is having, that is yellow color algae, yellow brown algae, will be having chlorophyll A and chlorophyll E. So these chlorophyll molecules are five types and they are divided like this in different living organisms that are performing photosynthesis. Then, coming to the second type of chlorophyll pigments, that is, second type of the photosynthetic pigments, that is the carotenoids. Carotenoids are yellow, orange, purple pigments. They are basically terpenoids present and they are open chain molecules. They are basically two types, carotenes and xanthophylls. Carotenes, in the sense, you can just say the color of the carrot, you can just say the color of the tomato, the color of this orangish red color that comes in the pomegranate, and all these all are carotenes that are present in the fruits. Carotenes are also present in the leaves, but the dominating pigment is chlorophyll. That is why the leaves appear green in color. So these carotenes are hydrocarbons. That is, they have carbon atom and an hydrogen atom. Example is lycopene, alpha carotene, and beta carotene. Coming to the xanthophylls, xanthophylls are oxygenated hydrocarbons. They also have oxygen atom in them. Example is lutein and zeaxanthin. So these are the structures. So you can just see how the carotene differentiation is seen in the orange color tomato and the red color tomato. These are the different colors that the carotenes and xanthophylls show. Just see. So beta carotene, zeaxanthin, lutein. So see the coloration of them, how it is orange, yellow, and ultimately going to red. So this is how the pigmentation color is there in the carotenes and xanthophylls. Yes, they are also present, but in very minute content, and chlorophyll pigments are dominating. That is why the leaves are green in color. This should be noted. The next and the last pigment is phycobilins. Phycobilins are the important pigments that are present in algae. That is the phycology subject, you know, the algae. Where red and blue-green algae will be having these particular pigments more. That is the rhodophyce members and cyanobacteria. The blue-green algae, in the sense, it is the cyanobacteria. Example that, Nostoc. So these are water-soluble pigments, and there are two types, phycoerythrin and phycocyanin. So phycoerythrin is that pigment which is giving a red color, pure red color in the appearance. Phycocyanin is that pigment which is giving bluish green color in appearance. So if you see the phycoerythrin mostly seen in rhodophyce members, that is red algae, and phycocyanin is seen in blue-green algae, that is cyanobacteria. We can also say mixophycian members. So these carotenoids and phycobilins, they are trapping the radiant energy. They are present in the green plants also, but in very minute components. That is why their color is not dominating. They absorb, they trap the radiant energy, and they pass it on to the chlorophyll A, because chlorophyll A molecule is universal in all the organism we have spoken. So they are passing them to the chlorophyll A, where that chlorophyll A is responsible to convert this radiant energy into chemical energy through photosystems, that is photosystem 1 and 2. We will be seeing them. Now, phycobilins, xanthophylls, carotenes, these are also present in the plants. But why they are color? Why are they actually present? They are not showing their color, right? You have to get this down. The thing is, these phycobilins, carotenoids are present in the plant in very minute concentrations. They are preventing the chlorophyll from photobleaching. That means the loss of the color, loss of the, that is a, the bonding gets, the leaf coloration becomes simply pale. That is called as photobleaching because of light. Photo means light. So the leaves, the green color leaves turn pale color because of the light. To prevent that, these carotenoids and phycobilins are responsible. So you can see in the diagram now I'm showing, this is the red algae having phycoerythrin, the red algae. And then this is the cyanobacteria that is present on the surface of the water bodies, which is bluish green in color because of the presence of phycocyanin. Next, coming to the another topic, that is light harvesting complex. We have said that in the process of photosynthesis, light, the radiant energy, is being trapped and it is converted into chemical energy. Then food is prepared. So here, first light is trapped and converted into chemical energy, and that chemical energy is utilized in the formation of food. So photosynthesis is of two types, so that is the light reaction and the dark reaction. We'll be seeing that in the coming slides. Before that, we have to see what are light harvesting complexes. Light harvesting complexes are those which where pigments are organized in photosystems. There are two photosystems present, photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. Each system has pigments forming these light harvesting complexes called as antenna. Antenna is one. Next to that is the reaction center with one chlorophyll A molecule. So in the antenna, all the other pigments are, that is chlorophyll B, carotenoids, these phycobilins, all are trapping the radiant energy in the antenna, and they are giving that radiant energy to chlorophyll A, that is only one molecule of chlorophyll A present in the reaction center, where the chlorophyll A is converting the light energy, that is the radiant energy, into chemical energy. So 95% of the light trapped in the antenna is transferred to the reaction center. So 95% is transferred to the reaction center from antenna into the reaction center. So this light harvesting complex is very important in order to capture the radiant energy. How they are captured? In the form of small photons, that is small packets of light called as photons or quanta. They are trapped and they are given to chlorophyll A. So if you see in the diagram here, see here, the pigment molecules are there in the antenna, that is the light harvesting complex, the antenna, all the different types of pigments are there, which is capturing the light. This light is captured and it is transferred to one molecule of chlorophyll A present in the reaction center, where that chlorophyll A molecule is responsible for the conversion of radiant energy into chemical energy. How that is actually happening, we will be seeing in the photosystems, that is in the next coming slides. So next we are going to see photosynthetically active radiation. What is it? PAR. Photosynthetically active radiation is the radiation of light which is responsible for photosynthesis, is called as photosynthetically active radiation. Which light is it going to take? It is going to take the visible spectrum ranging from 390 nanometers to 760 nanometers, that is the VIBG, or violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, red. So this, how are they taking the light? They are taking in the small packets, I told, that is photons. What happens is the photons which are coming from the radiant. So this photons having energy will be inversely proportional to their wavelength. So blue light has a, will be having more energy than the red light. So the PG, that is the important questions, important question for you all in the PG entrance of Usmania University will be which radiation, that is photosynthetically active radiation, in which radiation photosynthesis occurs more. So you can see they will give you blue and red. If they give blue option, blue and red, you can opt for blue and red. So what is happening when the light is absorbed? Absorption of light makes chlorophyll to enter the excitation state. That is, the chlorophyll will be entering the excitation state for about 10⁻⁹ seconds, and it is transferring that. When it is getting excited, it is giving out one electron to the next coming molecule that is present in the photosystem, and that we will be seeing now in the further slides. So this is how the photosynthetically active radiation is given in the diagram. And now you can see here in the diagram that the photosynthetically active efficiency, you can just see here, the efficiency of photosynthesis is high, right, when compared to the blue light, green light, yellow light. Okay, coming in the red, and that is from 680 to 700 nanometers, the particular photosynthetical activity will be more. Coming to the mechanism of photosynthesis, now entering into how the actual photosynthesis process occurs. Photosynthesis is divided into two phases. One is the light reaction and the other is the dark reaction. Light reaction, as we learnt now, that is, light reaction is responsible for the absorption of the radiant light, converting it into chemical energy. This is completely dependent on light, that is completely dependent on the presence of sun that occurs in the daytime. And this occurs, this particular light reaction, where it occurs? In the chloroplast. Where in the chloroplast? In the grana. So this particular light reaction, that is conversion of solar radiant energy into chemical energy, occurs in the chloroplast, that too in the grana of the chloroplast in the daytime. And the chemical energy they are releasing is NADPH and ATP. NADPH means nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide phosphate, and ATP is adenosine triphosphate. These are the energy sources that are released from the light reaction. And this energy is utilized, as I told you, photosynthesis is endergonic process. This energy which is synthesized in the light reaction is utilized in the dark reaction. See, the second one is the dark reaction, where the power, the energy, the assimilatory power that is produced in the light reaction will be converting now the carbon dioxide into the food, that is the carbohydrates. This phase is independent of light. That means it is not occurring in the night time. It occurs in the daytime also, but independent of light it occurs. If the energy is present, if the carbon dioxide is present, if all the required reactants are present, this reaction occurs independent of light. Some people say the dark reaction occurs in the night. No, dark reaction does not occur in the night. I mean, it is independent of light. That doesn't mean that it is occurring in the night. And where is this occurring? It is occurring in the stroma of the chloroplast. So light reaction occurs in the grana and dark reaction occurs in the stroma. This should be noted clearly, where this will be asked in the MSc entrance exams for your PG. Then light reaction. Light reaction is divided into three reactions again. The first one is Robert Hill's reaction, second one is Emerson enhancement effect, and the third one is electron transport, which includes the cyclic electron transport and the non-cyclic electron transport, which is also called as the Z scheme. Very important one. So coming to the Hill's reaction, Hill's reaction was proposed by Robert Hill. So Robert Hill is a biochemist from Cambridge University. In the year 1937, he worked on an isolated chloroplast. Instead of intact plant chloroplast, he has taken isolated chloroplast and demonstrated that these could release oxygen in the presence of sunlight and a suitable hydrogen acceptor. So what he said, in the presence of sunlight, these isolated chloroplast, if there is a hydrogen acceptor, they are simply releasing out oxygen. How, I will show you. See in the screen there that A is the hydrogen acceptor, and from the water molecule the hydrogen has gone and attached to the hydrogen acceptor. The hydrogen acceptor he used is 2,6-dichlorophenolindophenol. So it is dichlorophenolindophenol. Hill has used that particular hydrogen acceptor, and the hydrogens have attached to the particular hydrogen acceptor by releasing oxygen. So ultimately, Robert Hill has given a clear evidence that evolution of oxygen occurs from water, not from CO2. In the particular photosynthesis reaction, the byproduct oxygen that is being released out is from the water, but not from the carbon dioxide, was the actual concept the Hill wanted to explain. In plants, then, who is the hydrogen acceptor? In plants, NADP, that is nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide phosphate, is the hydrogen acceptor. By accepting hydrogen, it becomes NADPH. Okay, so it becomes NADPH. So this one is the hydrogen acceptor in the plants. Whereas in the experiment, he has used 2,6-dichlorophenolindophenol molecule, but in green plants, he has just taken an example of that isolated chloroplast and also related it to the green plants. That green plants are the hydrogen acceptor in the green plants is NADP plus, and that NADP plus is taking NADP plus is taking the hydrogen and it is becoming NADPH. So that is the hydrogen acceptor, and from water only the oxygen molecule will be released as a byproduct. This is what Hill wanted to explain. Then next, coming to the next one, that is Emerson enhancement effect. Now Robert Emerson is the person who has given this particular concept. He is from University of Illinois, USA, observed in chlorella. It is a unicellular green algae, chlorella.
that red light wave of wavelength longer than 680 nanometers lowers the rate of photosynthesis. So this decrease in rate of photosynthesis, in the presence of that red light, he was calling it as red drop. Now you just see in the diagram here, in the 680 nanometers of light when it is given to chlorella, the photosynthesis was normal. Okay, now when a longer wavelength of 700 was given, what happened? The rate of photosynthesis has got reduced. So when the rate of photosynthesis has got reduced in 680, the rate of photosynthesis was good. When a higher wavelength of red light was given, the photosynthesis rate was reduced. Where it was reduced? In the higher wavelength, that is the red light. That is why he named it as Emerson red drop. What has got dropped? The rate of photosynthesis has got dropped. So he has given it as Emerson red drop. Then finally, what he has done is he has given intermittent wavelengths, means he has given both shorter and longer wavelengths simultaneously. So the rate of photosynthesis was higher than the sum of the both rate of photosynthesis, what which was shown in the figure. If you just see here, the rate of photosynthesis when 680 nanometers was given, the rate of photosynthesis when 700 nanometers was given, if this both was added also, when intermittent light is given, the rate of photosynthesis was even more high. So he wanted to explain that both the wavelengths, the 680 shorter wavelength, that is 650 to 680 nanometers, and also longer wavelength above 680, that is 700 nanometers, are both essential and they are simultaneously given, that is taken by the plant for the process of photosynthesis. So when this particular rate of photosynthesis has increased, it was higher than the sum of the rates of separate beams also, it was higher. That is why he has named this concept as Emerson enhancement effect. So with this experiment, what he wanted to explain is the significance of this experiment. What is it? The significance is that it has led to the discovery of two photochemical reactions. That is what I was talking about. That is photosystems. Photosystem 1 and photosystem 2, both are present and both operate in series. That means photosystem 1 is going to take one particular wavelength and photosystem 2 is going to take another particular wavelength. So what he wanted to tell here is there are two photosystems, PS1 and PS2. PS1 is absorbing the wavelength of light, that is 700 nanometers, and PS2 is absorbing the wavelength of light, that is 680 nanometers. This is very important point. Another one important point I was telling you about the oppressed and the non-oppressed regions, that photosystem 1 occurs in the non-oppressed regions and photosystem 2 occurs in the oppressed regions. So non-oppressed regions are those where one thylakoid is in contact with the other. That is the oppressed region. And non-oppressed region is the those regions which are exposed to stroma. Oppressed simply pressed. You can, in the name itself it is given, pressed. That is one thylakoid is pressed one above the other, and that region is oppressed region. And what occurs in that oppressed region is photosystem 2 occurs in the oppressed region, and in the non-oppressed region, that is photosystem 1 will be occurring. So now these photosystems both are having light harvesting complexes, both are having antenna, both are having reaction center, both will be absorbing the radiant energy, and that is the trapping the radiant energy and convert it into the chemical energy. But they are responsible in the formation of assimilatory power. And how are they responsible in the formation of assimilatory power? We will be seeing now in the third reaction in the photosynthesis, that is in the light reaction, that is the Z scheme.
This is the Z scheme which we have to see.
Z scheme, in the sense it is represented in the form of Z, is simply you can say like this. It is the in the form of Z, that is why it is called as Z scheme. Now the importance of Emerson's work, what we have seen till now, the red drop and the enhancement effect, was first highlighted by Hill and Bendall in 1960. Once again, I'll write it on the screen. Hill and Bendall in 1960 proposed the how the two photosystems cooperate, and they have given this famous Z scheme, that is a schematic representation which is shown in the screen now. So what happens there, we will be seeing now. Here, photosystem 2 with 680 nanometers will be having chlorophyll molecule. Also it is having the antenna molecules with the reaction center. All the different pigments are there, where they are trapping the radiant light energy and they are giving it to the chlorophyll A molecule. Now this chlorophyll A molecule is, what is it doing? It is entering into excitation state, we have learned, for about 10 power minus 9 seconds. So this chlorophyll molecule in the photosystem 2 is absorbing the radiant energy given from the other pigments also, and it is getting excited and releasing two electrons to the next coming molecule, that is pheophytin. So this photosystem reduces the cytochromes and other oxidizes. So this scheme provides the basic information about how the electron transfer is occurring, how the oxygen evolution is occurring, and how the assimilatory power is being formed. This Z scheme will be explaining us. So there are different steps involved in the Z scheme. Now we will be seeing step by step, that is step 1. Photosynthetic electron transport begins with the absorption of sunlight by the chlorophyll molecules and other pigments. And there, the chlorophyll gets excited. Okay, exciting the chlorophyll, that is the reaction center. In step 2, what happens is, the electrons from the reaction center, that is the PS2, are conveyed to the next molecule that is present, is nothing but pheophytin, which is a special type of chlorophyll A in which magnesium central atom will be replaced by two hydrogens. So it is replaced, the chemical formula I'm talking about, the difference between the chlorophyll A molecule and pheophytin is that the magnesium atom in the center is replaced by two hydrogens. So, due to loss of two electrons, the reaction center PS2 will be oxidized now. Until the another electron comes, it is oxidized. Okay. So, it is oxidized and has transferred the electron to pheophytin. I will zoom it one second. Yeah. Yeah. So, that particular chlorophyll molecule has got excited and it has transferred the molecule to the pheophytin. Then the electrons are supplied. So how the electrons have been transferred to the pheophytin, then I have told you that the PS, that is the photosystem, has got oxidized. So there is a lack of electrons in the photosystem. So who is compensating that lack of electrons is the water splitting complex that is attached to the photosystem 2 is splitting the water molecule. Splitting the water molecule, that is nothing but the Robert Hill reaction which was told. This water molecule is split. It is giving two hydrogen atoms, half oxygen atom and two electrons. So this is how the two electrons are given to the photosystem. So what happens, the photosystem which was in oxidized states come back to its normal state by taking the electrons from the water splitting complex. This particular splitting of water in the presence of light is called as photolysis of water. The lysis means break
of water, that is photolysis of water, occurs, and the electrons are compensated in the photosystem too.
Then further, the electrons from the pheophytin, you know, the electrons are there with the pheophytin, and that pheophytin, now the electrons enter into the quinone cycle. Quinone cycle, that is having plastoquinone as the partly reduced plastoquinone is reduced to form plastoquinol. So plastoquinone is reduced to form plastoquinol by drawing one electron from photosynthesis 2 and two protons from the stroma. How this happens, I will be telling you in the electron transport chain. What happens is, when the electrons are taken from the pheophytin, that is the electrons taken from the pheophytin which enters into the quinone cycle, simultaneously for one electron transport, two protons come from the stroma into the lumen of the chloroplast. Now, where is this photosystem occurring? It is occurring on the thylakoid membrane, we have learned, that is on the grana, right? Right, reactions are occurring on the grana, we learned. So, two electrons getting transferred from pheophytin to plastoquinone, ultimately four protons are entered from stroma into the lumen. Then, coming to the next step, that is, let me take a pen, yeah. That electrons from plastoquinone are then given to the cytochrome BF6 complex. So cytochrome BF6 complex, ultimately you have seen that transfer of four protons into the stroma. Sorry, into the lumen from the stroma. So when the electrons are getting transferred from chlorophyll to pheophytin, pheophytin to quinone cycle, and ultimately to cytochrome complex, for transfer of one electron, two protons are coming from the stroma into the lumen of the chloroplast, and when two electrons are transferred, we are getting four protons into the lumen from the stroma. Then here, from the cytochrome BF6 complex, from the cytochrome BF6 complex, these particular electrons are conveyed to a complex that is a protein called as plastocyanin, which is made up of copper. This protein is having ability to move freely among the lumen side of the thylakoid membrane. It is called as the mobile carrier. Now, this particular plastocyanin is conveying the electrons to the photosystem 1. How? Now, meanwhile, this photosystem 1 is also absorbing the light energy. It is also having the antenna molecules, and all the different photosynthetic pigments are capturing the light energy and giving to the chlorophyll molecule, and the chlorophyll has got excited. And it has given its two electrons to the next molecule, that is nothing but it is iron molecule, ferredoxin, it has given. So, then when the two electrons are given to the ferredoxin molecule, loss of two electrons are occurring inside the photosystem 1. That loss of molecule in the photosystem 1 now will be compensated, because photosystem 1 has now given out electrons and it has become oxidized. Right? It has become oxidized. So for this, to compensate the loss of electrons, plastocyanin was bringing electron from photosystem 2, and that electrons will get transferred to this photosystem 1, that is P700, and that particular electrons are getting balanced. Right? Then where are the electrons from this photosystem 1 going? They are going to iron sulfur protein, that is ferredoxin. Okay, so this ferredoxin is conveying this electrons, means it has taken that electrons from the P700, and now this ferredoxin will transfer its electrons to, let me show in the diagram, to NADP+. This is very important. It is transferring the electrons to NADP+. And it is making the energy, the assimilatory power,
that is NADPH. So this NADPH is taking the electrons. Now you must get a doubt, from where is this oxygen coming for this NADP plus? Electrons are coming. Now if you remember that in the beginning, water molecule has given out two protons. Now those two protons which have come from the oxidation of water only will be taken by NADP plus. So who is remaining freely now? Once again. Here, from the water molecule, two electrons are used in the Z scheme. Two protons are used in the last, taken up by the NADP. NADP plus is taking up these protons. Now, who is remaining here? That is the oxygen molecule. So, about whatever the Hill, Robert Hill has explained in the Hill reaction, that when an hydrogen acceptor is present, in the green plants, the hydrogen acceptor is present. Those hydrogen acceptors are taking the hydrogen from the water and that is the electrons into the Z scheme, and remaining oxygen, what is there, is released out in the form of byproduct. This byproduct of oxygen is nothing but coming out from photolysis of water. So this is how the assimilatory power has been generated. Now, in between also, assimilatory power is generated when, so this is how the Z scheme is given by involving two photosystems. Now, if you see that Emerson enhancement effect is involving two types of wavelengths, they have shown, that is the intermittent wavelength, that is one shorter wavelength and one longer wavelength. That is, you can see here clearly, one shorter wavelength and one longer wavelength, both are responsible so that the assimilatory power is generated and photosynthetic rate will be more. If more assimilatory power is generated, more photosynthesis will occur. If less assimilatory power is generated, less photosynthesis will occur. So the both wavelengths of light is essential for the plants to perform photosynthesis. Now, coming to the next slide, this is the exact structure, how the photosystem Z scheme occurs. This all occurs in the grana, we have learnt. So these reactions, if you see in the grana, that is the membrane, that is the lipid bilayer model, this is the lipid bilayer model, and in the lipid bilayer model, in between the proteins are there. These are the proteins that are present in between. So here if we see the photosystem 2, 680 nanometers is taking the light. Whatever we have learned, the Z scheme, the same thing, by splitting of water by oxygen evolving complex, that is photolysis of water occurs, and then electrons are entering from pheophytin into plastoquinone. Plastoquinone is the carrier, which is we say lipophilic, that is it is present inside the lipid layer only. It is lipophilic, and then it is transferring the electrons to cytochrome BF6 complex, where the protons are entering into the stroma into the lumen. They are entering into the thylakoid lumen. The protons are entering, we have learnt. From there, the electrons are transferred to plastocyanin, which is a copper molecule. That is mobile carrier, we have learned. That is, it is lipophobic. It is afraid of lipids, and it is present on other side of the membrane. And from plastocyanin, now as the photosystem 1 is capturing the light energy and getting excited and lost 2 electrons, as photosystem 1 has got oxidized, the compensation of electrons is done by the plastocyanin. So these electrons compensation, then finally it has got transferred to NADP plus, where the oxygen is being sent there, and then these NADP plus are getting entering into ATP synthase molecule, and how the energy is released we will be seeing now. So this is clear till here, that NADP plus has been formed and accumulation of protons in the lumen are formed. Now coming to the next slide,
this is now the previous slide which we have seen is the non-cyclic electron transport. That is, there is nothing coming back into the photosystem II again. Now the next one what we are going to see is the cyclic electron transport. This means cyclic electron transport also occurs in addition to non-cyclic electron phosphorylation. Cyclic electron transport also occurs in the plants where only photosystem I is involved. That is photosystem that is the wavelength that is greater than 680 nanometers is involved. This was first demonstrated by Frankel in Rhodospirillum bacteria, where he has told that cyclic photophosphorylation is an additional source for the production of assimilatory power in the chloroplast for Kelvin cycle, and that assimilatory power is nothing but ATP, that is adenosine triphosphate is being coming from the cyclic electron transport is being told. Now in this what happens is the P700, that is the wavelength higher than 680 nanometers, what we have learnt is the P700 is going to take the energy, that is the antenna molecules, other chlorophyll, other pigments, photosynthetic pigments are capturing the radiant energy and making the chlorophyll A molecule get excited. When the chlorophyll molecule get excited, you know, again it get excited for 10 power minus 9 seconds and releases electrons, and that electrons are here transferred to ferredoxin that we have learnt in the non-cyclic electron transport also. From ferredoxin, these molecules, that is these electrons, are going to the quinone cycle, not to NADP plus, but they are instead going into the quinone cycle and getting transfer those electrons to cytochrome complex. So they are going back and they are transferring the electron to ultimately to plastoquinone, and plastoquinone will be giving its two electrons back to the P700 because P700 has already lost its two electrons and it has become oxidized. So this oxidation of that one, the electrons come to the P700 back, and this is the cyclic photophosphorylation where the ATPs are generated, and this is an additional power of what we say the assimilatory power that is present for preparation of food in the plants. So this one, there is no evolution of oxygen, there is because there is no photolysis of water, so simply the ATP is formed and the cyclic electron transport also occurs in the plants. Now all these electron transfers, the cyclic and the non-cyclic electron transport, will be responsible for the accumulation of hydrogen, that is the hydrogen atoms, that is the protons, in the lumen of the thylakoids. So how these lumen, inside the lumen, how the accumulation of these protons must be removed out of the lumen, and that procedure will be calling it as photophosphorylation, where energy again is made. How is that energy made again? We will be seeing. Before that, we will see one video. Let me show you one video. So in this video, it is explaining that the whatever I have explained now will be explained, that the photon is being taken and then how that photon is exciting the chlorophyll molecule and how the electron is being transferred back to the photosystem. This is the cyclic photophosphorylation by that is forming the formation of ATPVC. So how the energy is being, this occurs by in the photosystem I, that is P700, by taking 700 nanometers of light, right? So this is already learned. Now we are going to see the non-cyclic electron transport. In the non-cyclic electron transport, the P680, that is the photosystem II, is taking the photons, that is the light, the reaction center and the antenna both taking, and the chlorophyll A molecule is exciting and releasing one electron to the excited reaction center. From there, it is going to the pheophyton, and the compensation of electrons here is done by the water revolving complex. We have seen just now how the electrons have been here. The loss of the electrons in this particular one is by water splitting, and that is the water revolving complex. The electrons are compensated back, and the electron is taken by pheophyton. From there, it is coming to the plastoquinone cycle, then cytochrome B6 complex, which is involving the entry of hydrogen molecule, that is the atoms, into the lumen. Plastocyanin is giving to the electrons to the P700. Meanwhile, what happens? The P700, you know, we have already learned that it is taking the radiant energy. Right, that radiant energy is taken by this photosystem 1 P700, and there that chlorophyll is going to get excited for 10 power minus 9 seconds. See, the photon is being taken by the all the antenna molecules, and it is given to the reaction center, going to ferredoxin, and what is released here? NADPH, the assimilatory power is released, and this assimilatory power is now will be utilized in the Calvin cycle. So when this particular process is occurring, this is simultaneously occurring. See here, the photon is taken, excited, water is giving the electron back. This particular photosystem 1 is also occurring, and then electron is compensated into the photosystem 1 back by plastocyanin. So this way, the assimilatory power in the Z scheme is running, and also sometimes cyclic electron transport also occur, and their ATP is released. So this is how the assimilatory power, NADPH and ATPs, are released in the Z scheme occurs in the plant. So hope this video is clear to you all. So that is what the cyclic and non-cyclic electron transport was. Now we have to see that the accumulation of hydrogen molecules have occurred in the lumen of the thylakoid. So when accumulation of the hydrogen atoms occurred, the protons occurred in the lumen, those will want to move out of the thylakoid, because the proton gradient will be, concentration gradient will be increased in the thylakoid, and they wanted to move out of the thylakoid. But thylakoid wall is not permeable for the protons. It is impermeable for the protons to move. Hence, they will have this particular complex that is shown on the screen called as ATP synthase molecule, which was first described by Daniel Arnen. It is the one which is producing ATP. In the presence of light, only these particular protons are entering into the lumen. So this particular process is called as photophosphorylation, formation of phosphates in the presence of light, because of light only the protons have got entered into the lumen of the that is the thylakoid. So here the non-cyclic electron transport, we have seen the accumulation of protons, that is 2 protons from the water molecule and 4 protons in the near the cytochrome B6F complex. There what happens is, here we are having one stalk of the ATP synthase molecule. This stalk is called as F0, and the head is called as F1. F0 F1 molecule, that is the ATP synthase molecule, which is having a proton channel in the center. This proton channel is responsible for the movement of protons. It is said that, it is generally considered that when three protons move down the potential gradient. Here the hydrogen potential is more, the concentration is more. When they are moving down the potential gradient across this particular synthase molecule, one ATP is generated. ATP is generated. So in this non-cyclic electron transport, whatever Z scheme we have studied so far, 2 protons are from the water molecule and 4 protons are from the cytochrome B6 complex got accumulated in the lumen. So total 6. As we learned, when 3 protons move, 1 ATP is released. Here 6 protons are there. That means totally 2 ATP molecules are released in the non-cyclic electron transport. That is, in the Z scheme, ultimately results in 1 molecule of NADPH and 2 molecules of ATP that is released in the this particular Z scheme. So we will be seeing this now in a video.
So in the video that ATP synthase is a molecular mill, what is happening is, see, these blue color ones are on the lumen. In the lumen, these blue color ones, you can, these blue color ones are the proton gradient that is being increased in the lumen, and these are entering into the proton channel. This rotor will be rotating by taking the protons that are coming from the lumen and transfer these protons into back into the stroma. So these proton gradient, when the protons are moving across the lumen in the head of that particular ATP synthase, that ATP synthase will be rotating and will be releasing ATP molecule. So we have learnt that, let me take a pen once again. We have learnt that three protons will be responsible for release of one ATP. So what happens here, you see, when one proton will come, ADP, oh my god, one second. So coming back into the video, when, let me show you here, let me pause it, we take a pen, yeah. So here in the knob, what happens is, we have learnt three protons will give rise to one ATP molecule. So what happens is, when one proton comes, ADP and inorganic phosphate come near the rotor. When another proton comes, there will be a loose bonding between ATP and inorganic phosphate. Ultimately, when the third proton comes, that ATP and inorganic phosphate will combine to form ATP. So this is called as the open site, loose site, and this is the tight site. There will be three sites in the rotor, that is in the knob of the ATP synthase. Three sites will be there where So there will be three sites present in the rotor, in the knob. So what happens is that when three molecules are moving, ultimately three protons are moving, one ATP molecule is formed. See, the red one is the ADP with one inorganic phosphate is attached and ATP is released. See, adenosine diphosphate with one phosphate has released that particular one. And this is how the... So this is how that ATP synthase is responsible for the production of ATP. And in non-cyclic electron transport, six protons are released, and these six protons are responsible for the formation of two molecules of ATP. We have seen in the diagram also how it happened. Now next slide, we are going to synthase. We have learned, now we are entering into the dark reaction. It represents the second phase. It is independent of light. Already told you that it is independent of light. That means it does not occur during the night time. It is independent of light. It is not requiring light for its process. Now, the depending upon the first stable compound by taking carbon dioxide, there are three cycles, that is C3 cycle, C4 cycle and CAM cycle. C3 cycle is called as Melvin-Kelvin cycle, and C4 cycle is Hatch and Slack pathway, and CAM cycle is seen in carcinogenic, it is acid metabolism, called as carcinogenic members it is seen. Now C3 pathway we are going to study today, which was given by Melvin Kelvin and along with his associates Benson and Basham, who has discovered this pathway in chlorella and named the cycle after Kelvin, called as Kelvin cycle. It is also called as photosynthetic carbon reduction and reductive pentose phosphate pathway, because photosynthetically carbon is getting reduced by addition of hydrogen to form glucose. Hence, it is called as photosynthetic carbon reduction. And reductive pentose phosphate pathway means we see many 5 carbon compounds in this particular cycle. So we will be seeing that in this pathway now. This pathway is divided into three phases. The first phase is a carbon fixation phase, the second is the reduction phase, and the third is the regeneration phase. Now what happens in this actually? First, the carbon dioxide is taken by the plants through the stomata, we have already learned, and it is accepted by ribulose 1,5 bisphosphate molecule in the presence of an enzyme called as RUBISCOM, that is RUBP, that is ribulose 1,5 bisphosphate carboxylase oxygenase. It is an enzyme that is having dual nature. In the presence of that, it becomes, it first forms a 6 carbon unstable, because ribulose 1,5 bisphosphate is 5 carbon compound and carbon dioxide is having 1 carbon. Ultimately, it has to become 6 carbon compound, but the 6 carbon compound is going to be unstable and it will be splitting into 2 molecules of 3 carbons. So that 2 molecules of 3 carbon is called as PGA, that is nothing but phosphoglyceric acid, which is a 3 carbon compound having 1 phosphate in each compound. Now this 3-phosphoglyceric acid is going to take ATP, that is formed in the light reaction. It is going to take ATP and that part in the presence of enzyme phosphoglycerokinase to form 1,3-bisphosphoglyceric acid. Bisphosphoglyceric acid, because already 1 phosphate is present, and by taking ATP it is gained another phosphate, that is why it is called as bisphosphoglyceric acid. Then this 1,3-bisphosphoglyceric acid is going to take NADPH. That is NADPH, nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide phosphate, that is formed, that assimilatory power that is formed in the light reaction is taken in the presence of an enzyme glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase. So glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase you can see here glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate molecules, it is a pool of them, that is 12 molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate are formed, because the molecules has been started with 3 molecules each. Ribulose 1,5 bisphosphate is 3 molecules and carbon dioxide 3 molecules. So totally they became 6 molecules. Then 6 molecules have taken 6 molecules of phosphoglyceric acid. These all are 3 molecule compounds, that is 3 carbon compounds, and they splitted into the pool of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate pool. And here we are going to see that 3 molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, that is this 1, 2 and 3. These 3 molecules are going to take an enzyme called as isomerase, and they are getting converted into dihydroxyacetone 3-phosphate in the presence of the enzyme triose phosphate isomerase. They are the isomers of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. Clear? Now, the first dihydroxyacetone 3-phosphate is now directly entering into the cytoplasm for exosynthesis, the synthesis of glucose. Then, here, 1 DHAP and 1 glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, both are combining in the presence of an enzyme called as aldolase. In the presence of an enzyme called as aldolase to form fructose 1,6 bisphosphate. Here fructose 1,6 bisphosphate, we are talking that it is 6 carbon compound. That means glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is a 3 carbon compound and DHAP is a 3 carbon compound. Both of them are having phosphate in it. So ultimately it will form a 6 carbon compound with 2 phosphates. That is why it is called as fructose 1,6 bisphosphate. Now this fructose 1,6 bisphosphate is losing one phosphate, one inorganic phosphate is lost. You can see here in the diagram here, one inorganic phosphate is lost to form fructose 6-phosphate.
So here fructose 6-phosphate, when before it was called as fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, it has lost one inorganic phosphate to form fructose 6-phosphate. Now this fructose 6-phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate both are combining and splitting into two molecules, and here the enzyme is called as transketolase. In the presence of an enzyme transketolase, fructose 6-phosphate is a 6-carbon compound and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is a 3-carbon compound. So ultimately they must result in a 9-carbon compound, but they are splitting to form 1,5-carbon compound and 1,4-carbon compound. The 5-carbon compound is called as xylulose 5-phosphate and the 4-carbon compound is called as erythrose 4-phosphate. So this way the xylulose 5-phosphate and erythrose 4-phosphate are formed in the Kelvin cycle. Now this particular xylulose 5-phosphate, we will keep this aside for some more time. We are going to talk about the erythrose 4-phosphate that is combining with dihydroxyacetone 3-phosphate, the isomer of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, to form acetyheptulose 1,7-bisphosphate. Here, erythrose 4-phosphate is a 4-carbon compound and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is a 3-carbon compound that will ultimately result into a 7-carbon compound, that is acetyheptulose 1,7-bisphosphate, because erythrose is having 1-phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is also having phosphate. Both phosphates in one molecule, it becomes acetyheptulose bisphosphate. Now this acetyheptulose bisphosphate is also losing one inorganic phosphate to form acetyheptulose 7-phosphate. Acetyheptulose 7-phosphate. So here the enzyme is acetyheptulose 1,7-bisphosphatase, because one inorganic phosphate is being lost, it is bisphosphatase enzyme. Now the acetyheptulose 7-phosphate is combining with glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate again. Now acetyheptulose 7-phosphate is a 7-carbon compound. It is combining with another glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, which is a 3-carbon compound. Ultimately it must result in 10-carbon compound, but it is splitting into 5-carbon and 5-carbon compound. If you see here, one is xylulose 5-phosphate and the other is ribose 5-phosphate. So this is xylulose 5-phosphate and other is the ribose biphosphate. Here the enzyme responsible for combining and splitting into molecules is transketolase is the enzyme. Now these molecules are all 5-carbon compounds which are formed here. Now I told we will be talking about the xylulose 5-phosphate of this xylulose 5-phosphate. Again here xylulose 5-phosphate has formed. Again ribose 5-phosphate has formed. These all are the 5-carbon compounds that are formed in this particular cycle. Hence this pathway is dominating with 5-carbon compounds. It is called as reductive pentose phosphate pathway, also called as RPP cycle, reductive pentose phosphate pathway. So now these all 5-carbon compounds are converting themselves into ribulose 5-phosphate in the presence of an enzyme called as ribulose 5-phosphate. Now I have to tell you, ribose to 5-phosphate is one enzyme. Now, one second, let me take the pen. Yeah. From ribose 5-phosphate to ribulose 5-phosphate, the enzyme is isomerase enzyme. That is, ribulose 5-phosphate isomerase is the enzyme. From xylulose to ribulose 5-phosphate, the enzyme is epimerase. That is, ribulose 5-phosphate epimerase is the enzyme. From xylulose 5-phosphate to ribulose 5-phosphate is the epimerase enzyme, and ribose 5-phosphate to ribulose 5-phosphate is the isomerase enzyme. Now here, this ribulose 5-phosphate is going to take ATP, that is energy assimilatory power, again with the form phosphate, and it is converting ribulose 5-phosphate to ribulose 1,5-bisphosphatase, 1,5-bisphosphatase, because already they are having 1-phosphate and they are taking ATP. So 2 phosphates in one molecule, so ribulose 1,5-bisphosphate again regenerated back. So if you see here, the carboxylation phase is the fixation of carbon dioxide, the reduction phase, and again this complete thing will be the regeneration phase. This is the carbon fixation phase, reduction phase because hydrogen is added, and then complete again the molecule is being regenerated. So this is called as regeneration phase. Completely 3 phases are there in this particular C3 cycle. So this is how the enzymes and the cycle are occurring in the C3 plants. If you come to the energetics that we have to see, for reducing 3 molecules of carbon dioxide, totally 6 molecules of NADPH and 9 molecules of ATP are required. They're taking. From where are they coming? These molecules are coming from the light reaction, the 6 molecules of NADPH and 9 molecules of ATP. In order to obtain 1 hexose molecule, that is 12 molecules, because 3 carbon molecules we are talking, but in glucose, what happens in glucose, there are 6 carbon molecules. So we are talking about the reduction of 3 carbon molecules. For 3 carbon molecules, it is 6 molecules of NADPH and 9 molecules of ATP. So hexose is having 6 carbons. That means you have to double. 6 molecules will become 12 molecules of NADPH and 9 molecules will become 18 molecules of ATP. So ultimately, for formation of 1 glucose molecule, the cycle will form, will utilize 12 NADPH and 18 ATP molecules. Where are these generated? These all energy sources are generated in the plant in the light phase. We have already seen in the light phase how the assimilatory power is being formed and how now it is utilized by the C3 plants for the formation of glucose. So now coming into the last topic of today, that is factors influencing photosynthesis. Yes, there are different factors influencing photosynthesis. There are 2 types of factors, that is, the first one is the external factors and then the internal factors. External factors in the sense that factors which are present outside the plant that are influencing the photosynthesis process. So when we are talking about the external factors, the first one is the light. Light is the first one. Light is very essential and important element that is responsible for the rate of photosynthesis. And 3 things in light, that is the quality of light. The quality of light is important, where maximum photosynthesis occurs in the red light and then it is followed by the blue light. So mostly the red and the blue light of the VIBGIO or the visible spectrum, what we have learned, the rate of photosynthesis increases. So the quality of light is very important. Coming into the next one, that is the intensity of light. That is the intensity, that is the wavelength we have learned, that is 390 nanometers to 760 nanometers. And the light, mostly the red light, that is photosynthetically active radiation, in that the red light which is showing maximum photosynthesis, the intensity of the light is also, the rate of photosynthesis increases with the increase in the intensity of light. So this is both are directly proportional. Now we say the plants, that some plants grow in shady regions also with low light intensities. Such plants are called as, I'll write with red pen, xeophytes. The plants that are growing in shady region are called as xeophytes. That means in low intensity of light. There are also plants that are growing in sunny regions of the sunny regions where the intensity of light is very high. They are called as heliophytes, where the higher light intensities are seen. And then coming into the another quality of light, that is the duration of light. If the duration of light is continuous, the rate of photosynthesis will be disturbed. But if the rate of that is the duration of light is intermittent, that we have learnt in our Emerson enhancement effect, that if the light is intermittent, shorter wavelength and longer wavelength, that is light in flashes, photosynthesis will be more. So this is how the light is affecting the influencing the photosynthesis. Then next, coming to the temperature, temperature also plays a different role in the photosynthesis. Some plants like conifers, the gymnosperms, photosynthesize in minus 6 degrees. Certain bacteria, cyanobacteria, photosynthesize at 70 degrees. But generally, the general temperature is from 10 degrees to 40 degrees. How much? It is from 10 degrees centigrade to 40 degrees centigrade, the rate of photosynthesis will be increasing. That is, the temperature also will be influencing the rate of photosynthesis. Increase in the temperature up to 40 degrees, there will be increase in the rate of photosynthesis. Next factor we are going to see is carbon dioxide. Yes, the carbon dioxide is the prime raw material for the fixation of formation of carbohydrates. Normally, the carbon dioxide is just 0.03% in the atmosphere. If there is an increase in the carbon dioxide level, there will be increase in the rate of photosynthesis. So carbon dioxide is very prime raw material, so it is very important for the plants for photosynthesis process. Next one is the oxygen. Oxygen is not utilized in the photosynthesis, but if we see that oxygen is released out during photosynthesis in the photolysis of water, when the water molecules are splitted and the oxygen molecules are released. Now, there is a scientist named as Warburg. Warburg, he has suggested that if oxygen high concentrations are there in the atmosphere, photosynthesis will be stopped and instead another process will be started. That process is called as photorespiration, which is not good for the plants. So low levels of oxygen will increase the rate of photosynthesis and high levels in the oxygen will decrease the rate of photosynthesis. Then the next one is the water. Water is very essential as the splitting of water molecules we have seen. Now, water is the rate of photosynthesis will decrease if water deficiency is seen. So this water becomes, if water is becoming limited in an area, then the efficiency of photosynthesis will reduce. It will affect the photosynthesis. So these external factors are very essential for the plants to maintain and for the process of photosynthesis to run smoothly. Then coming to the internal factors. The internal factors, that is the chlorophyll content, the internal structure of the leaf, the accumulation of end products also will be influencing the rate of photosynthesis. How it is the chlorophyll content. The amount of chlorophyll content in the leaf will be having direct relationship with the photosynthesis. That is, if the leaves have got etiolated, that means if the leaf has got pale, the color of the leaf became light and pale, then the chlorophyll content will be decreased and the photosynthesis also will get decreased. Even if the age of the leaf has increased, the leaf becomes pale because of the loss of chlorophyll in them. So when the chlorophyll is lost, slowly the photosynthesis rate also will reduce. Next, coming to the internal structure of the leaf. The internal structure of the leaf includes the thickness of the cuticle, the structure and distribution of the stomata, the mesophyll tissue. The mesophyll tissue will be having chlorophyll, chloroplasts in them. The stomata distribution, if there is a stomata continuously closed, then how the carbon dioxide is taken into the plant? If carbon dioxide is not taken into the plant, food is not formed. So all these factors also influence the photosynthesis. The last point is accumulation of end products. Yes, when the C3 cycle is continuously occurring in the plant, continuously hexose molecules are formed inside the plant. When these hexose molecules are formed, they are called as the end products. If they are not translocated from the leaves to the different parts of the plant, then what happens? The accumulation of that particular end product will stop the rate of photosynthesis. That means it will inhibit the process of photosynthesis, resulting in what happens? There is no photosynthesis occurring in inside the plant. So translocation of that food materials from the leaf into the different parts of the plant through conductive tissue, that is phloem, is very essential, because if that transportation is not seen, the end products will get accumulated in the leaf only and will inhibit the process of photosynthesis. So where are these food end products going? Is they are going into the fruits, where the food material is getting stored in the fruits, and the leaf is continuously performing its process of photosynthesis. So this is how we have learned the light reaction and the dark reaction. In dark reaction, we have learned only C3 cycle. C4 and CAM are also there. But for today, for this session, we have learned C3 cycle and all the factors that are influencing the photosynthesis process. So much. That's all for the session today. We have learned about the light reaction and in dark reaction about the C3 cycle. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.